So I will be giving you two further talks on the subject of who creates certain things for the game. The players or the organizers or both together, of course. And the first of these two is about culture. The culture in the game with the characters. And I'm hoping that I have some examples a little bit later, so I hope those will clarify more also what is meant by culture in this context. So basically, whether it's culture designed by the organizers or culture workshopped and designed by the players or something between those two, who is responsible for creating this material. And some of the sort of concerns that you might want to think about when you consider this issue is how important is it that the culture is exactly like this in your game? If it's if you think that it doesn't really matter that the culture can be like this or it can be like this, whatever works for the players, then you can have the players create more of it. While if you have an idea that it has to be exactly like this for the game to work, then it's maybe better to create it, have it created by an organizer. So that's what I mean by fidelity to an idea of the organizers. And of course it's important to consider what exactly is the idea and what is important. You can focus on that and leave the rest to the players. One sort of danger in leaving the rest to the players is the danger of stereotypes. Sometimes stereotypes are good because they help us understand stuff really fast. But the problem with stereotypes is that they are stereotypical. And sometimes they are not interesting, sometimes they are boring, they are unoriginal, and sometimes they can even go to things like being racist. So those are the sort of problems of workshopping stuff really fast, because then you tend to go with obvious ideas. But on the other hand, of course, when you create culture with your together with the players, you create a living culture that comes alive and is more natural than you can have if it's just handed down from the organizers. I will give you an example just of the sort of issues that can come up with creating culture from the Monitor Celestra. It's actually a kind of an interesting case in terms of where the culture comes from, because in the Monitor Celestra it doesn't come from the real world, or it's not completely created by the organizers or the players, but rather much of it is borrowed from two television series, the more famous Battlestar Galactica and then the other one, Caprica. And the organizers of course have to pick up like what exactly they want to focus on in this sort of wider collection of materials contained in the television series. And one of the choices they made was to focus on issues of race, which are less present in Battlestar Galactica and more present in the television series Caprica. And of course the players, when they play in the game, they will also create culture during the game, before the game, and they will use whatever they know of the series, of the sort of base material they have, which is the television series, to sort of create the stuff and improvise it. But one of the problems in Celestra in this regard is that you are more enabled to create culture and improvise stuff with more confidence if you know the television series really well. Well, if you don't, then you are less enabled. And to sort of combat this problem, the organizers chose to create more culture sort of on top of the television series, especially the culture on board the ship Celestra, on which the LARP was set. So the world, the bigger culture of the bigger world, things like religion and stuff like that, came from the television series, while the working culture of the on board the ship was more organizer created to give the players a better base for improvising even more culture while they were playing the game and before the game. Another example of culture creation in practice comes from Melanie Himmelokhav, in which it's also a good example of this kind of the choices you make in regard to the fidelity to an idea, what is important and what you can leave to the players and what you have to get from the organizers. In this LARP, there was this society with a science fiction society with four genders. And having those four genders as a sort of gender deconstruction was the sort of important part that was came from the organizers, that this is what we should have in this game. But the sort of what are the sort of cultural conventions built around those genders was the specifics of that were not so, it was not so essential that they were exactly like this. And because of that, those could be left to the players to create in workshops, giving them. And the benefit you get from this is player ownership and investment, that the players feel that it's their culture, that this is something we built and this is our life and so on, which means, of course, creates better play. The min and max positions for these two faders are really arbitrary. I put them like this, but they can be the other way around too. Doesn't really matter. But here is the fader max is organizers create all of the culture, or as much as is possible. The benefits of doing it like this is that you can have it really consistent. You can create a really consistent culture. Everything can be exactly like you want it to be. It conforms to your creative vision as an organizer. It's consistent, and also importantly, you can go beyond your own ideas. It means that you can do things like say that 90% of the time it's like this, but 10% of the time it's like this. And this is harder to do when players improvise stuff because they don't know where those limits are. But if you create everything yourself, you can break your own rules more easily because you know how it's supposed to be. You have the big vision to do that, where the players don't generally have this kind of a top-level idea of how it should look like. And the downside of just having everything come from the top is that it completely disregards player creativity and participation, meaning that the players might not feel so invested in it and have more distance to the whole thing. And of course it's creatively kind of a little bit boring to do it like that, because it's role-playing and LARP is a co-creative art form. As an example of a LARP where the culture was really top-down is Halat Hisar. Because in our game it was really important to us that the culture of the occupation was on a kind of a very small level, very everyday level, reflected many of the things that happen in real life. And we were very afraid of the stereotypes because we thought that if the players go to a LARP and instead of just improvise the culture, it means that they are not learning what happens in real life, but instead they are just exploring their own preconceptions and own prejudices of what happens. They are learning stereotypes and not reality, or some version of reality. So that's why we wanted to be very controlling. But the picture you see here actually demonstrates also the folly of doing it like this, or folly of this as any kind of an ideal, because in a sense you cannot have a completely organizer-created culture. In a LARP, the players will always create culture, whether you want them to do it or not. And some of that is happening right here. A lot of the stuff we gave top-down, but at the same time, especially everyday culture of resistance to the occupation was largely created during the game. What happens here is that you have a group of people who have linked hands in a circle. And of course, that's something people do in real life too, to escape arrest. But we didn't like brief players to do it. We didn't tell them that you can do this, but they just came up with it during the game. So it's the soldiers are trying to drag away somebody from the circle right there. So it's an example of just a cultural form that appears even in our controlled environment. And of course, that's a good thing. That's something we want to happen, even in our case. So the other end, fader mean the player's workshop culture completely, like with as little guidance from the organizers as possible. In this case, the players, the benefits are that the players know the culture very well because they are invested in it, they created it, it's their culture. And they are very comfortable with it, because if there's stuff they are not comfortable with it, maybe they can sort of drive it to another direction. They have a creative agency with the whole thing. And I think that's an end in itself. We have a co-creative bliss. We love just doing it together. It's wonderful. So I think that from this perspective, it's always a good idea to have players create a lot of stuff. But there's some downsides to it. Like I said before, workshopping sometimes leads to obvious ideas that you need to. Sometimes, of course, also co-creation and workshopping leads to really original ideas, but not always. Sometimes it just leads to stuff that's the simplest thing people can think of in the moment. And of course, it takes time. If you can have like 3 weekends of workshopping before your LARP, before the game begins, then go for it. If you have 1 hour of workshopping before the LARP begins, maybe don't go for it, because it's work to do all that stuff. And I have an example here. It's a small game I organized a couple of years ago at a role-playing convention. It's set on a base in Antarctica. It's an example of a special case of player-created culture. I don't know how many people here know what is the working culture on a scientific base in Antarctica, but I would guess that not many. And the players didn't know either. And when I was briefing the game, it was played in a role-playing convention, could be played right here, the very small game. But I didn't tell them what the working culture on a base like this is, because it was one of those cases where I will brief them for half an hour and then they go in. And what this means is that the players create all of the culture in that game by default. Because you will always have culture, so they just make up some assumptions without possibly even talking about it. They think it's probably like this. And that is in fact the process of creating culture. So if you don't do it, they will do it. And you will have a fader position by default. I think this probably happens in many of the games you play during the school, sort of automatically. You go into this default mode. So the mid-level position, of course, I think is probably most common with this fader, because organizers have some desires and the players have other desires. And other possibilities, and it will come out anyway, and so on. So it's just more of a question of what's important to focus on for the organizers and what you can leave for the players. And as a general rule, I would just like to repeat that the players will always create culture. I will just move from this straight to the other one. Okay. You're on it?
Yeah.
Excellent.